I'd like to now call the meeting officially to order. The first thing I'd like to do is review the minutes of our previous meeting on March 17th, 1997. Anyone have any comments or revisions? Hearing none, does anyone have a motion?
Motion to accept the minutes as written.
Second.
Okay, any discussion of the motion? No? All those in favor indicate so by raising your right hand. It's unanimous. Now I'll move on to our second item, which is a recap of correspondence received by the Planning Board over the last month. We have a letter from M. Stanfield regarding the Sprague subdivision. We have a letter from the Conservation Commission regarding the coastal program. We have a memorandum to Town Council from the Planning Board regarding the addressing ordinance. We received a copy of the zoning news of March 1998. We have a memo from the Planning Board to the Town Council regarding the Town Center referendum. In addition to that, on the podium this evening, we received several other items of official correspondence. These included a memo from T. Emery to the Planning Board and the Council regarding Town Center, a letter from the Conservation Commission regarding the Lawton public access waiver, a letter from R. Wolf regarding the Sprague subdivision, a letter from E. Huber, also regarding the Sprague subdivision, a letter from W. McCurdy, again regarding the Sprague subdivision, and the last item we received was a memo from the Conservation Commission regarding the Greenview Drive application. That being covered, I'd like to move on to our first application on the agenda this evening, which is a previously submitted application for the Sprague Master Plan Subdivision, a request by the Sprague Corporation for preliminary subdivision review of a 60-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road. This evening, under Section 16-2-4, Preliminary Subdivision Review Public Hearing. And to start off, I'd like to request that the applicant bring us up to date on the current status of the application and give us a summary of where we are right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Terry DeWan. I'm a landscape architect in Yarmouth, and I've been working with the Sprague Corporation for the last several months on the applications before you tonight. As you know, we were on a site walk last month, and because one of the members could not make it that meeting, we had another very exciting site walk about a week ago that was culminated by the appearance of the hook and ladder truck, which brought us throughout the property, pretty much following the same track that the Planning Board went on the initial site visit. As you know, this is a very lengthy application. It can be a fairly complex matter. And at the last meeting of the Planning Board, we suggested that we may want to spend some time this meeting going over some of the very specific elements of the application that probably in our minds, and probably yours also, need the most amount of exploration and discussion, because there are so many different avenues that the Planning Board could take these issues. Those, of course, are those issues dealing with roads and fire protection. And we would like to spend our allotted time, and the scheduled calls for 20 minutes tonight for the discussion, talking about under roads, improvements to existing roads, the standards to be used for any new road construction, emergency access, and the length of dead-end road issue. And then under fire protection, we'd like to talk about fire protection measures that are either in place right now or upgrades that will be made to the overall property at some point during the development of the 40 lots that we're talking about. So that was what we would like to see accomplished tonight. We don't have any major new pieces of information to give you. We do have a couple of sketches which we'd like to put on top of the site plan as a means of talking about some of the issues that we feel are germane to the discussion about road length. So if that pleases the chair, we'd
like to pursue that.
So roads are really quite an issue, and as we know, we spent a lot of time both talking with Maureen, talking with the planning board, the fire chief, town engineer, and so forth about the issue of roads. And we, of course, always have to look back to the comprehensive plan and the subdivision ordinance to see what is being said relative to those issues. Comprehensive plan on page 45 talks about the issues of roads, and we feel that that's really what we should be looking at in terms of looking at the issues relative to preservation of the natural character of the property. Without getting overly repetitious, there are a couple of things in the comp plan that talk, we feel, specifically to the property out here, although the comprehensive plan doesn't really address the core issues of dealing with roads on private property, but we feel that there are things which the comp plan is saying. For example, under recommended implementation, retain existing trees, stone walls, rock outcroppings, and other natural cultural features when undertaking road improvements. Things that have been done already, revise existing dimensional and construction standards for arterial, feeder, and local roads in order to provide flexibility to ensure future road improvements result in minimum loss of town rural character. The town's subdivision ordinance, of course, also deals with the same issue with a lot more specificity. If I may indulge in reading just one paragraph from page 25, the purpose of the subdivision road standards are to minimize traffic safety hazards and the cost of municipal maintenance and reconstruction to ensure that roads are consistent with the town's rural character, to promote a sense of community, and to be consistent with the comprehensive plan. The standards shall be flexible where an applicant can demonstrate that alternative approaches will meet the above stated purposes. And I think that last sentence that talks about the need for flexibility in dealing with a specific situation is one that we'd like certainly the board to keep in mind as we go through the discussion about how the roads should be upgraded, where upgrading is needed, how to deal with the issue of emergency access, and lastly, how to treat new roads that are being proposed throughout the property. If I may first then look at the areas of upgrades, and there are many places, for example, the Breakwater Road through here, the Pomeroy Road that goes to Gayfields, and many other places where there are either existing tracks out in the woods right now or all-weather roads that may not need the technical requirements of the town's ordinance that should be upgraded to some standard. When we were out there last week with the fire truck, we felt it was very informative. The fire chief himself was driving. He drove at a reasonable and prudent speed. We didn't find many places where we wished the road was any wider to accommodate emergency vehicle access on the whole hour that we were along with him. What we've done in this drawing here, this is the diagram that you saw last time, is outlined in these various blocks what we feel is a reasonable width of a road that we would like to see the existing roads brought up to. In many places, we recognize that these are not up to the town road standards, but we feel, based upon the amount of use that's anticipated here and the overwhelming desire to keep the character of the whole estate pretty much intact, we feel these are very appropriate standards. Most of the roads that we have driven on, both the whole planning board and then last week, are in the 12 to 10, some places 14 feet in width range. For the use that's out there right now, and for what we feel to be the anticipated increase in use, we feel that those are very workable road widths. We've shown on here at various blocks for all the roads that are either there or proposed to be constructed, what we would like to be considered as the standard that we're going to be proposing as part of our application. In some places, you see a 12 over 18, for example, on the Breakwater Road. That road right now, which is, of course, the main road coming in off of 77, that now serves three homes and ultimately will serve an additional six for a total of nine. In other words, the entire eastern portion of the Sprague property. The road is now in the 10 to 12 foot width. We would like to bring that up to 12 feet. And in periodic places, for example, at Seasonal Pond and at bends in the roads and other places where it's necessary to allow vehicles to pass, our proposal is to widen the road out to 18 feet in width. These are roads that every day accommodate delivery vans, UPS vehicles. There's a lot of logging going on here that certainly are built width-wise and depth-wise to accommodate that sort of use. We find there are minimum number of people that are on the road. These, of course, are private roads. The public is not invited down these roads, and they are posted such, and there is very little traffic on the roads as they now exist. So the 12 feet is what we're considering to be the optimum width. The 18 feet is what we're saying would be done in periodic locations to meet the requirements of the fire chief and to provide places for two vehicles to pass if that was to be necessary. What would be done to upgrade the roads? And this, I think, in taking an overall look at all the roads that we're looking at here, we feel there's a number of steps, five or six, that should be applied throughout the entire Sprague estate. First of all, the minimum width would be the 12 feet. We feel, as I just said, this is what the people who live out there now have been accustomed to, and we feel that's very much in keeping with our desire to keep the character of the property intact. We would be working with the fire chief to make sure that by driving either the pumper trucks or the ladder truck throughout the property on all the back roads and all the emergency loops, that there are no places where there are trees that are too close to the edge of the traveled way, that the corners are adequate, that any improvements that need to be made would be made in a timely manner. We do know, for example, that there are some places where the curve is almost impossible to make. In other places, for example, just the other day, coming out of Little Pond Lane, turning left onto Monastery Road, we were surprised that the fire truck had no problem making that turn. It might be advisable to add another couple of feet of gravel just to facilitate that. We don't feel in this situation right here that it's necessary to relocate the road, as we had talked about earlier. It was a real object lesson for us to see the actual vehicle that would be driving the roads in that unlikely case of an emergency, to see how the truck would react to those situations. We realize in some places the chief made it through with literally inches to spare, and there are many places, there may be 40 or 50 trees throughout here that would have to come down to widen the road out to make sure that a person driving the truck could drive through here with the proper amount of speed to respond to an emergency. The third point in terms of upgrading would be to add a gravel base throughout the road system. We know after rainstorms that some of the roads, especially Little Pond Road, of course is a Japanese pond road, have puddles, have standing waters, are not quite properly drained. Those, of course, would have to be brought up to a higher elevation. 6 inches is probably a good average. We'd be working with BH2M engineers to advise us if there's any areas where we may need to have additional gravel brought in. Again, we'd be working with our engineers and the town engineers to come up with a section that would be appropriate to the situation. Those are the steps that we feel would be appropriate to bring the road to the standards that, in our estimation, meet the requirements for emergency access, day-to-day access, as well as maintain the town character. What is the object in doing this, of course, is to provide day-to-day access to these locations. And as we know from looking at our here, that most of the access comes off of the Fowler Road with the Charles Gordon Road. There are relatively few existing lots or new lots would be coming off of new roads. What do we want to avoid? We've provided a photo simulation, which is right here. Pass this around. What we've done here is taken an existing road, the Ram Island Farm Road, that is right in front of the stone cottage. That's the way it looks right now. It's 10 feet, 12 feet wide. Through the wonders of computer simulation, we've increased it to 26 foot wide. This is obviously the widest that the town standards would require it to be. That's the 18 foot wide travelways and 2 4 foot wide shoulders. We just do this for purposes of exaggeration and evaluation of what it would look like. But it gets back to the issue of maintaining character of the property. For all intents and purposes, the road width as it presently exists meets the travel demands, the safety demands for the people who live on the property. It's our feeling also that if roads were to be widened from their present width up to, say, 18 or 20 feet, it would encourage people who live on the property to drive faster, perhaps not to be as careful as they should be. There's a lot of bicycle and horse and pedestrian use on the interior roads. People driving faster may not have the presence of mind to watch out for those people who are using the trails and the roads for recreational purposes. Right now, the roads that do provide the linkages between the different parallel roads, Little Pond Lane and Japanese Pond Road, are very lightly used. By increasing the width of those roads, we feel that may encourage people to drive them more, disturb more wildlife habitat, again, to diminish the recreational value of these properties. We've just completed a wetland evaluation. We don't know yet how much wetlands would be disturbed by widening the roads, but we have had Woodlawn Alternatives go out and do an evaluation of all the wetlands that are on either side of both of these roads that are part of the emergency loop system. And finally, by adding more, by requiring more upgrades to roads, to fire protection devices, and so forth, we feel that there's that much more incentive to either sell off land for purposes of fundraising for these amenities or requirements, or it instills a sense that this is more of a traditional development. And I think that's certainly not the intent of anybody on the development team or within the family. All this being said, of course, that if, and this is certainly just a wild if this land were ever to be offered for sale on the open market, which is not the case right now, and we can address that later on, and Seth is here to talk about that, if circumstances change, the town requirements would certainly be applicable to any changes that would be made to the approved plan. I think that's important to keep that in mind, that the plan that's being approved is for the people who are living out there now, family members, and people who really understand the value and the character of the property. In terms of emergency access, as I've said, there are the two segments of road, Little Pond Lane and Japanese Pond Road, that we feel by upgrading them to the 12-foot width with the 18-foot periodic pullouts does provide enough width for the fire truck. That was certainly proven to us by driving the truck through there last week by the fire chief. We will be making the upgrades and the improvements as noted. I think it really boils down to a question of risk management. Who really is putting whom at risk by leaving the roads the way they are? I think it's instructive to look at the history of the property. In talking with the property manager, John Green, And Seth, we might expect a fire once every, how many years? 10 years might be a good round number to look at. How many times are the roads closed? Perhaps once every 3 to 4 years. And this usually happens, and this is a freak of nature, usually when a tree blows over or an ice storm closes the road. And this does happen periodically, but usually it's an occurrence that can get cleaned up very quickly. In talking with the chief the other day, it was brought to our attention that the fire trucks all have emergency equipment. There's chainsaws on the fire trucks, that if there was a road blockage down here, let's say, that the first truck in would simply take the fire department's chainsaw out. And they apparently they test that before they go out on the runs and simply clear the brush or clear the tree out of the way. The option, of course, is to, if it was blocked, is to back the truck up and then go down here and to respond to a fire that was down, say, in this area right here. The question is it more time-consuming to cut your way through a downed tree or to back the truck up and go down this way? And I guess if you're looking at a situation like the ice storm, let's say, or a major, any sort of storm event, if there's a tree down here, the chances are very likely that there would also be a tree down someplace along these other areas that are designated as emergency access ways. I certainly can't speak for the fire department. It would seem like if there was a real need to get through there, it'd be very easy to go get the chainsaws and go through that obstruction rather than try and work our way around. That, of course, is not to deny that there's other purposes to for the emergency loop road. There are other emergencies that may come up, but the most likely one that seems to us would be to get access to a location where there's a fire at the same time that there was a tree or some other obstacles. We don't know what the mathematical probability of those two events happening at one time, but that's all part of the whole discussion about risk management. Another issue relative to the whole discussion has to do with the length of dead-end roads. Now, as you know, the board has some flexibility to waive certain standards. There are other parts of the ordinance, as Maureen has pointed out in her memo to the board, that there is a mandatory clause that is put in the ordinance. That, of course, has to do with roads that are greater than 1,000 feet in length, and secondly, that hassle has, there's also a restriction on any road being greater than 2,000 feet in length. Once a road is more than 1,000 feet in length, it's mandatory that a road has to be 24 feet in width and other requirements be met. There are two locations where we find this to be problematic. One is the Kilwani Trail right here on the side of Blueberry Hill, where there are four lots that are served by this proposed new road that goes through the orchard. The other one is Sepoki Trail up and through here. It's our feeling that to have a road of 24 feet in width just doesn't make sense coming off a town road, Fowler Road, that's only 20 feet in width. The same thing we feel is inappropriate down here on Kauai Trail. Where, again, we have a road that goes through an orchard that really wants to be a fairly wide driveway that goes between the trees that services these four lots down here. What we've done is developed a series of alternatives to explore some of the options that might be available to us and to have a discussion with the planning board about whether or not these are things that you want to see, that we want to see, and trying to resolve some of the issues regarding these two situations. Just to back up a little bit, lots 114 and 115 are the two lots that we saw as we drive into the farm at the intersection of Fowler Road and Charles Jordan's Road. There's a little gravel road, actually more of a dirt track that goes across the open fields. There are two lots that are up against the pine trees several hundred feet back from the end of the road here. The problem, of course, is that this is more than 1,000 feet in length. From this intersection right here, it would require us to have what we feel to be an inordinately wide road section given the location. what could be done there. And we're not suggesting this is the proper way to handle the situation, but there's two options come to mind at this point. One is to have a road that's only 1,000 feet in length, and that's 1,000 feet up to that point right there. And from that point, there's simply a continuation of what is now the dirt road into the house site. Another option would be to have a driveway that goes up through the field. I don't know if it makes a lot of sense to do this, to stop it right there. The proposal that's underneath simply takes the driveway, upgrades it to the 12 feet in gravel width, and provides frontage for both lots, keeps the houses back among the pine trees, and it seems like a logical way to deal with the situation. It does not envision a road that's 24 feet in width going through the field there. Another option, this one is even, we feel is less agreeable, but certainly might be doable in terms of the ordinance. Be to do away with the idea of any new road there altogether. It's simply bring the proverbial pork chop lot down to the road. It's got its minimum 125 feet of frontage. You could probably still maintain this as a common driveway with an access easement off the remaining land, or we could simply have a driveway here and a driveway here. The latter approach certainly goes against the grain of what we're trying to do out here. In other words, minimizing any disturbances to Fowler Road, Charles Jordan Road, which really in our estimation are public resources that really need to be guarded. And that's one of the overriding principles throughout all this planning exercise. Let's take a minute and look at the other four lots down here. Again, the same approach is used. These are the four lots that as we parked down next to the barn, we looked up on the hillside, across the field where the cattle were grazing. There was one lot on the edge of the woods. There were three additional lots that marched their way down the open slopes of a field that had periodic trees in it. From the public road, we would not be able to see any of the new houses. There would be a new driveway at the brake line between the orchard and the woodlot that goes along the woodland and bends and goes up the side of the slope. Again, you barely notice it was there, but it would provide access down to these four lots. The bad news, of course, that it's over 1,000 feet in length, and by definition, the town is mandated to require that road to be actually 4 feet wider than the public road that now serves it. What's the option? One option is to bring another spur road from this road right here up to that point right there. So the dead end road situation really starts getting captured at that point. And so technically we have about an 800 foot long dead end road, and the fire truck would have two options to get in here. That to us is a lot of disturbance of the existing field out here, but it technically does meet the requirements of the ordinance in our estimation. Another option, again, this is one that we don't feel is very workable because it goes against the grain of the people that have been responsible for the development of the plan, is to abandon the idea of putting houses back there and take advantage of the road frontage and simply show four homes that are either in the orchard or set back into the trees along the woods here, but having the minimum lot size of 80,000 square feet, which is roughly 640 by 125, a little bit wider than that. But it does show a situation where you can have the same intensity of development without the added expense of bringing the road down to this point right here. We go through these exercises for a couple of reasons, one of which is to try and explore options that we feel are available to the client in going through the ordinance. I think it's also useful to understand that there are some situations that the drafters of the ordinance probably didn't think about when they were
developing these standards for road construction 3 or 4 years ago. And at that point, I suppose we'll open it up for discussion to the planning board, knowing that we're kind of at a quandary here dealing with those issues. Before I do that, there are a couple other things as well as fire protection. I know that we started a discussion last time about the various steps that we would be taking in terms of meeting the requirements for fire protection. The ponds that you see on here right now, let me take one diagram off. We had, as part of our application to the planning board, gave the board a listing of all the ponds that are out on the property now. We also showed where improvements have been made to depth, to bottom conditions, to the size of the pipe, and so forth. We are showing by red dots on this plan right here where the fire hydrants, the dry hydrants, either are in existence right now or would be added as part of the development of the overall plan. There are a number of places that we didn't talk about last time. For example, there is another fire pond, Monk's Pond, that's not part of the overall application for you, but we feel it's important to realize that it is there, again, in an emergency that the fire department needed another source of water. There is a pond right here. There's another pond right here. There's another pond that you didn't even color in, but it is supposedly available. Seasonal pond, as we saw the other day on our trip, is connected by a man-made canal that goes to the larger pond out here, and that's a very good source of water because of the depth and the water that can draw from. We've also talked about adding the second hydrant, the Japanese pond, even though it's quite a distance from any of the nearby development. Other improvements that we've made with fire protection, in places like this where there is a hydrant next to a pond, we'd be making sure there was a good gravel base next to the pond so a proper track would pull off without danger of sinking, and also widen the road at that point to make sure that the trucks would be able to pass in an emergency. In the future, of course, again, that scenario that's that what if that this ever became not a Sprague Corporation property, there's a lot of other options that a private developer could do, but we feel, given the character of the land and the concern that people have shown who live out here, we feel these are really the appropriate steps that do need to be taken. There was a letter that we received from Mr. Wolf. We would like to quote from one paragraph from him. And this is a letter from Dick Wolf, who has had the privilege of living out here for 40 years. He dated this April 13th. He wrote it from his home in Florida. And just to highlight one paragraph, those of us fortunate to live here have always assumed the risk of being without fire hydrants, and we have paid the additional insurance premium gladly. The same situation occurs all over rural Maine, and that is what the Sprague land is, rural Maine. It would be a travesty in these days of enlightened greenbelt, open space, and natural environment awareness and activism to require the same road and fire protection standards in this magnificent piece of native forest land as one finds in many lot-sized subdivisions. This is a unique piece of property that has been saved from commercial development. It should not be commercialized by zoning statutes. Sincerely, Richard Wolf. So, with that, I would like to turn it back over to the board for comments on the issues of roads and fire protection.
Thank you. At this point in time, at last month's meeting, the applicant requested a public hearing be held this evening in order that the application proceed on a timely basis. And I think now that the information has been presented and we're as up to speed as anyone, that this would be as good a time as any to hold the public hearing. Therefore, without any further delay, at this point in time, I'd like to open the public hearing And any member of the public who would wish to come to the podium and offer thoughts or insights into the application at hand, we'd be very eager to hear what anyone would like to say. Yes, please.
Can I come to the podium?
Yes, come to the podium, give us your name and where you live, and tell us any thoughts you may have on the application.
My name is John Higgins, and I'm perhaps the largest immediate neighbor to the Sprague Corporation. I live on about 37 acres of land down on the water at Ram Island Farm. And I have reviewed the project in depth, both obviously here this evening, but also with the Sprague Corporation separately and John Green. And I really find that it is an extremely responsible piece of work, and I support it fully. In terms of an impact to me as a neighbor, I find it very good, very cohesive. I travel the roads a great deal in terms of walking and everything, and I think that the ability of fire trucks to get by is very easy. And I, in general, am very supportive of everything that's been done. I think it's a very responsible piece of work. So those are my comments.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to offer some comments?
I'm Julie Sprague, and I don't live here anymore, but I really appreciate the extent that my family's been working with the town and trying to resolve future issues of this magnificent piece of property, to maintain the open green space, to be cognizant of one's safety, and to assure the town that we enjoy the open space and trees and the beautiful day like we have today. I know we have bad days too, but suffice to say, when we get a good spring day, we all really appreciate the openness of Cape Elizabeth and the rural aspect of this town. And I did go to school here from kindergarten until seventh grade, the public school, half the year and half the year down in Florida. So I get a little anxious when I see too many cluster houses and I say, oh, they're changing too quickly. But I do think that my family and their professional supporters have really worked very diligently to come up with a cohesive plan. They've interviewed many different land planners and have spent countless hours selecting one that we thought would be helpful to the family as well as our interaction with the town. As you know, we do not have town water, and we do not have a sewer system. And I think our objective for this core piece of property is to ensure our future generations, and I am a great aunt, I hate to admit it, have house sites that they can live and enjoy as our grandfather had the wisdom to put together for our family. And I really hope that the town will work with my family in a positive way, and that we might be proud of Cape Elizabeth in a great way. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to come to the podium and share any thoughts on the project with us? Oh, next.
My name is Nat Clifford. I live at Breakwater Farm. Where are we? Right in here. Next door to Dick Wolf, who wrote a letter far more eloquent than anything I can say. So I'd first like to say that I certainly agree with him and thank him for putting better words out than I can. In the perhaps three or four terms that I served in the Conservation Commission, we were constantly haranguing developers coming before us about the rural character of the town. And while certainly I recognize the need for adequate fire equipment access for public safety purposes, in the 40 years or so that I've lived here, I have yet to see a case that loomed up to me as anything that put us at risk. As Dick Wolf said in his letter, We assume certain risks, lacking fire hydrants and that kind of thing, but I don't think we've ever felt that we were in any way isolated from protection afforded by the fire equipment. I can remember some years ago, some kids torched a car down by the breakwater, and the equipment had very little trouble, to my knowledge, getting in. In fact, I know they came in two different ways. Also, going back over the years that I've lived here, and even before that, as a high school student, I worked on the farm, and I'd hate to say how far back it was, but there was some logging work going on at the time right in the middle of the woods. And since then, similar operations have been conducted involving large trucks going in and out. I think one effect that that's had is to soften some of the curves on the roads and perhaps make them accessible to the type of equipment that we're using now for fire protection. At one point, we had to do some work on the road, and this was probably 20, 25 years ago, replacing a water line and actually blocked off Breakwater Road for a couple of days. And all the people living there, the three houses, came in through other routes around Charles Jordan Road or coming in through the Monks Road and up through. This included delivery trucks, and again, I'm not aware that there was ever a problem with that. For years, Ted Wainwright, who farmed way down at Spurwink, came up through with all kinds of equipment, tractor trailers and that sort of thing. And again, no problem moving through these roads. I guess this is my way of saying that as a practical matter, I don't see the widths of the roads as being a problem from a fire protection standpoint. And I'm extremely concerned about losing the look of the place and also the use of these roads. There are kids out there on horses and bicycles and people walking, and please don't tell the mail delivery people, but I and my neighbors have often somewhat mitigated the degree to which we graded the road just so that you tended to hold people down to a slightly lower speed. So I would urge the planning board to carefully hear Mr. DeWan and the reasons that they and we believe that things should be kept as soft as they can in terms of the appearance of these roads. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to offer some comments this evening? Yes, please.
Just to be very brief, my name is Jeanette Hagen, and I'm a Sprague family member. And my husband and I are also abutters. We live down at the end of the Breakwater Farm Road. And I've been asked by my immediate family, my children particularly, to speak to you just very briefly about the roads. They really, the roads, trails, and paths really make up the character of that special piece of property. And we have had logging trucks, vans, farm equipment down those roads. And we've had generations of teenagers learning to drive. And we've been able to do that really without incident. And so we're happy with the way the roads are, and we hope that you'll take that into consideration.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to offer some comments? Well, seeing no one else interested, I'll close the public hearing and move on to board discussion on the subject of roads on the property. I guess at this point in time, if anyone has any board members have any questions about the sort of proposed road system, which is has been presented to us, I guess it would be, we could offer more questions of the applicant or launch right into discussion ourselves.
I have a question.
Yes.
To our planner. Can we waive road widths according to the ordinance?
There is a section in the ordinance that allows the planning board to waive standards, and you can waive a lot of different things, but you cannot waive the dead-end road standards.
I understand that.
But the other road widths, you can waive. You have to find that you're not creating an unsafe situation and that you're doing the waiver consistent with the comprehensive plan.
As you know, I've been concerned about the road widths, and having been the lone member to ride a fire truck, a ladder truck, with big triple folded ladder up on top, in the front seat, I will say that it was with a maximum of difficulty that we negotiated Little Pond Lane. It was tough. And I think the fire chief was very brave to try it with all of us aboard. And at the time, I commented that I thought that a house would probably burn down if the fire truck was forced to access a burning house down Little Pond Lane. Something has been rattling around in my mind. And I want to say I thoroughly appreciate your wanting to keep the rural, the beautiful rural character of that property. It's gorgeous. It's absolutely gorgeous. But at the same time, I am concerned about fire protection and emergency vehicles, the MedQ, the rescue unit, reaching people in a hurry. I just wondered if it would be possible for, this is just an idea, for the fire chief to negotiate a system that would accommodate him and accommodate the Sprague estate. Would that be possible?
I'm not sure what the question is. Are you?
Well,
I think the fire chief, unless he's changed his mind in the past week and a half, has been, it's the last time I talked to him, was still fairly adamant that yeah, he wants to adhere to our standards.
Yeah. And but would it be possible to, you know, to have turnouts on Breakwater Farm Road, for example? Which at least is straight. It just seems to me that some negotiation has to go on. That's my idea. How do people respond to that?
I just, if I could, I'd like to answer your question more specifically about waivers. It's in section 16.3.5. And the board does have the authority to, where the planning board finds that undue hardship, practical difficulties, or restriction upon imaginative or otherwise desirable design may result from strict compliance with this ordinance, it may waive one or more of the following requirements in favor of a proposed alternative. You have to find, however, that the alternative will not create more hazardous traffic conditions or less sanitary sewage disposal conditions, will provide more varied and imaginative subdivision layout and design, will secure substantially the standards of road design and construction required by the ordinance, and will not have the effect of nullifying the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan.
Just an idea.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments relating to that? Yes, David.
What were the comments of the chief during the last trip he took?
Well, the first time it was that he'd be more than happy to take the rest of the planning board out there as long as we could schedule a time when he was also available. So that's that's something that we had discussed, and he's more than willing to get you all out in the ladder truck, which is, as Nancy can attest, a fun ride.
Very.
His concern, and I really hesitate to speak for the fire chief, because when it comes to fire protection, he is very eloquent in explaining exactly what his issues are. There were a couple of things I noticed. One was that on roads that I would have thought would have been more than adequate for the fire truck, I was sticking my head out the window, watching the rear wheels, and they were off the lane a lot of the time, in places where I never would have thought the road needed to be wider than you would think. The other issue that he has, well, he's got, the other thing is it's really good to ride in the front of the ladder truck, because you can't imagine what it's like to have 6 to 8 feet of ladder protruding approximately 13 feet off the ground. So there's a whole turning issue that you normally wouldn't think about. But his main issue is not with getting the ladder truck down the width of a road, because frankly, the roads that are down there, for the most part, are wide enough for the ladder truck. Yeah, there were a couple of trees that came this close, but you know, with those few exceptions, you can get the ladder truck down one way. The problem is he's looking for two-way travel, because he wants to be able to have a pumper truck pass each other. His concern is that because there is not public water down there and there are not fire hydrants, that he needs to rely on ponds. And so he's hoping that if he can't carry enough water in a pumper truck down to the fire and put out the fire, that he's going to have another pumper truck passing one and the same in the opposite direction to ferry water back and forth. And that was his, if I understand correctly, his major issue with the width of the roads. But again, you know, I don't want to be speaking for him. I really think it's important for him to be able to state his case.
Any road areas in particular that he was concerned about?
Well, he was concerned about the road that I mentioned, Little Pond Road, which is in Brown, which is a twisty, turny road, very narrow. It's like a logging road, and there are, in some places, there are huge pine trees on either side, so that if he had missed, you know, he would have had a banged up fire truck on one side. It was very, very narrow and curvy.
Can I just speak
to that? Yeah. Yes, please.
That, in the plan, we acknowledge that road needs to be wider. And our intention was to have an organized trip with the tree chief and pick out the trees that needed to be removed so that the access could be clear. But instead, the chief showed up and without notice and just drove through the trail, which was, turned out to be okay, but we know that the trees need to get moved out of there. And it's part of our plan to upgrade the road.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That was not made clear to us.
Yeah.
Who were riding on the truck.
There were a couple of places, if you recall, there was one place where there was a tree that was leaning over like this, and I pointed out to the chief, that's an example of a tree that obviously would come out. Another place where we all held our breath, we were that close. Mm-hmm. You know, I said there's a lot of trees just like this one that are going to have to come out. I think in my initial presentation, I said, I think that John has already counted at least 50 trees that are just like that, that would have to come out. Again, working with the chief to both take out those trees that would cause the road to narrow down, and also to upgrade the width up to the 12 feet we've talked about. In some places where we were really off, and you look back and you saw that the wheels were indeed off the travel way, the road was probably only about 9 feet wide at that point.
And you would not be addressing the problem of two trucks going in opposite directions.
Not the entire length, but no. We are saying.
And he is concerned about that. And that's a legitimate concern, I think. And that's why I mentioned turnouts at certain places. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. That might be a reasonable solution.
If I can indulge the chair for a moment as well. My name is John Green. I'm the property manager. I also attended the site tour. The linkage you're referring to on the Little Pond Lane, that is would be probably appropriate for one direction, because you would not be shuttling water in that area unless an extreme emergency. But the most part, the chief is concerned with Breakwater Road, the need for these homes, and remember, there are only three existing ones there now, the need to perhaps, in an emergency, shuttle water. And we feel we will create the opportunity to have one truck sitting at the hydrant, and the ladder truck will accommodate. We will have ample room for that to make a pass either direction with the truck at the hydrant, as well as several locations, a log landing halfway down Breakwater Road, as well as other locations up the road where two trucks could easily pass. In fact, we have photographs where we have trucks the same size as the pumper trucks that would shuttle water. So we feel Breakwater Farm, even at full build-out of nine lots, that there is more than ample opportunity for safety vehicles to make those two passing directions. Little Pond Lane is really the direct access here, and the shuttling would probably occur there. This is in, Little Pond Lane would be used more for an emergency should this be blocked. The opportunity to shuttle water at that point, I'm not sure there'd be anything left to shuttle water to by the time we got through there. And I see no need with, there's chestnut trees, rare plants, wetlands involved. To widen that road for, have two trucks pass in both directions would be very destructive to that habitat. You know, I see Breakwater Farm Road as accomplishing the need for the shuttling. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Parker.
If my memory serves me correctly, during Terry's initial delivery this evening, you mentioned, I think, that there were going to be possibly some gravel areas next to the pond so the truck could be off the road. You said that you recognized there are certain portions of the road that do need to be widened, some trees do need to be taken down. It seems to me that it makes sense for you to meet with the fire chief, show him what you're planning on doing. I guess one question I have for you, the proposed widening of the different areas that you are speaking to, I assume this is all backed up by the family as well, that they are in agreement with, you know, certain portions of certain roads will need to be widened and certain trees will need to be taken out.
Maybe I should let Seth address that issue.
I'm getting sort of two different signals here, and I'm not sure if everyone's in agreement.
We were saying that we acknowledge the need to make sure that these links here, as a secondary access, emergency access, will be passable by an emergency vehicle. And on the Little Pond Lane, it's going to be necessary, as we saw when the ladder truck was down there, to take out trees in order to get in there. But only we're trying to minimize that so that you can have a straight shot on a secondary access requirement. You can't get down through here, that you could come around here and get straight up to the site of the fire.
Okay, I guess the question I'm asking is the family or whoever is in charge of this, are you in agreement with all of this, that these certain changes do have to be made? Maybe I should rephrase this.
There is a mechanism, family mechanism, in the corporate form where there's officers and a board of directors.
I'm not asking that. I'm hearing from different members of the family tonight saying that they really want roads to stay as they are. But Terry's initial opening comments were that we acknowledge that there are some changes that have to be made. I just want to make sure that everyone's on the same page here.
What we really want is as is wherever possible, and it's only those specific areas around hydrants. We talked about seasonal pond here. We've got to make sure that two trucks can pass that hydrant readily there. But it's a minimal change. We're looking for a minimal change.
Thank you for the clarification. You know, with that being said, I don't think there's, well, the new members of the board probably won't recognize this, but when we did the road standards a number of years ago, I was the biggest advocate for narrowing the roads as much as possible in every instance in every area of the town. And so I'm not going to have any problem with the roads being kept basically the way they are, just because it's a magical place to be able to go into Maine of 150 years ago and have it only 15 minutes in the city of Portland. And these people who are going to live there, they are accepting that risk of possibly losing a house because of possibly inadequate fire ponds or difficulty with emergency vehicles getting to their property. If they're willing to accept that, it doesn't bother me a bit.
Any other comments? Mr. DeWan.
Just to clarify some of the students, some of the fire ponds are inadequate right now, but the schedule that we presented as part of our application shows that all the fire ponds will be brought up to standard for the chief will work with us to design in terms of increasing the depth, making sure that the size of the pipe meets his requirements, making sure it's a gravel base, that the access to the ponds are all sufficient to gain year-round access to the ponds.
Okay.
So, in other words, Terry, you will be negotiating with the fire chief?
Yes, I see this as being an ongoing discussion with the chief, yes.
Well, we just use different words.
Yes.
But he's the one who has to drive that truck, or one of his team.
That's correct.
And that's a big project.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Yes, David.
Could we get Mr. DeWan to go over that on road, just the dimensions that you were very specific at the Saturday tour as to what you had in mind. I just wanted you to clarify the widths, the average widths that you're thinking about and what you propose.
This is
that section.
The Japanese Pond Road?
That's one area, but the Pond Road that
Little Pond Lane,
Lane is a critical area, and I think you acknowledged that on our trip, and I just thought if you'd just review that with us, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. Little Pond Lane right now, if we do have some photographs here, just to refresh your memory, these were taken with some of the Spray Corporation's trucks in place. You want to pass that around just to get a recall of what it looks like. In places, Little Pond Lane right now is 10 feet wide, some places a little bit less, a couple of places a little bit more. There are a sequence of wetlands that are found throughout there. There is a fair amount of up and down and a lot of back and forth. What we're saying is that the minimum width that we would put out there would be 12 feet in width. And bringing up the gravel depth, probably an average of 6 inches or so. There are places where trees would have to be taken out to ensure that there was good clearance both laterally and overhead. And again, using the ladder truck is a good tool. And as was mentioned, the truck does stick out quite a bit. It is an awesome sight to see a truck go down this road at 25 miles an hour. Knowing that requires good three-dimensional skills to maneuver through here. We want to make sure there aren't any obstacles like that. We had talked initially when we came to the intersection of Monastery Road, if you recall there's a very sharp turn that goes around some big trees, straightening the road out and coming to more of a T intersection right there. When we were out there the other day, the fire truck didn't even slow down, but it was speeding up at that point to make that curve. There's a slight rise. At that point, we probably want to look at a little bit more width on Monastery Road or some way to accommodate the turning vehicle to make sure that the wheels are always on solid ground. But it's a very site-specific level of improvements.
So your minimum width that you plan is 12 feet through this?
Correct.
Thank you.
Mr. DeWan. I have perhaps a more succinct question along the same lines. The application package that we have right now in most of these areas, or quite a few of them, indicates a right-of-way and not an actual drawn road. Do you intend to draw roads and turnouts prior to our preliminary approval vote, or do you see that as an overly technical issue?
I guess that's an issue which we'd like to work with.
We've talked a lot about it. There's been a lot of research into the concept of widening here and there, and I would think that by this point in time you might know where those points are. Mm-hmm. Do you intend to show that to us, or is that something that you want to wait for final subdivision?
I guess we'd prefer that we wait for final. We're still reviewing the wetlands, as I mentioned earlier, and it will require going out there, working with the chief, town engineer, and so forth. What we would like to have as part of the preliminary application is a vote from the board to approve this approach, that the widths that we're showing here, the level of improvements that we've outlined today is the proper one given the situation. And then from there, as we said earlier, proceed towards final with a more defined set of plans.
Okay. Any other members of the board have any comments on that? Yes, Steve.
I have a motion.
Surely.
Motion for the board to consider. Steve ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted for the March 17th meeting and the facts presented, the application of Sprague Corporation for major subdivision review, a resource protection permit, and private access waivers for the 60 plus or minus lot Sprague master plan subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road be tabled to the regular May 19th, 1998 meeting of the planning board.
Thank you.
Second.
Second. We have a motion that has been seconded. Would there be any discussion at this point on the motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'm sure that
yes.
The applicants will want to know where do they go from here. We've got this motion to table until the next meeting, but do we have some tasks for them to come back with?
I think that's a very good thing that we should discuss what we're all thinking of in terms of looking at the next meeting.
Took the question right out of my mouth.
Yes.
What additional information could we give you to help you work through this discussion?
Well, I personally would be greatly relieved if you could work with the fire chief in the next month. Would that be too much to ask? And agree upon some improvements to the roads that would be appropriate for emergency vehicles?
Well, ultimately, whose decision is it as to the width of the road? It's my understanding the real final decision has to be made by the planning board.
It is, but we would like some recommendations from the fire chief that would be acceptable to you people. It is our decision, but this is a difficult application, I think, because it's not a private developer going to sell lots and develop like that. It's a long-term thing. It's more of a master plan for the land. And in that respect, it's not like the usual application. And so as far as I'm concerned, I'm a new member anyway, so I'm feeling my way, but I'm sure the older members are also feeling their way.
Yeah. Well, I'll go a little bit further, and fellow members of the board can comment on this. I'd like to see a plan that shows on the face of the earth how wide the roads are going to be and what's proposed to be done. I realize this is preliminary, so it doesn't need wetlands reports and wildlife consultants and DEP submittals and all of that, but I, for one, before I vote on this, would like to see what it is you want to do. On paper, on paper.
This information right here.
Where the turnouts are, it doesn't have to be graded out and consultant to death, but just what is it? I think that would help anyone in terms of looking at it overall. I think that's sort of a bare minimum from my perspective. you know, you draw a plan. Does anybody else on the board have any feelings that that's onerous?
Only that I agree with you, Mr. Wilcox.
Oh, thank you, Peter. Yes, Mr. Parker.
I think maybe a letter from the fire chief might be really important for the board to be able to read, to say that he'd gone out there with you specifically to look at specific areas that need to either be widened or what needed to be done. He had a discussion, and in fact, you were willing to do those things. I don't think anyone is expecting you to make these roads wide enough for two trucks to pass on every foot of the road. It just doesn't make sense. So, you know, if we could just get a simple letter from him stating that you've met with him, you've addressed his concerns, and if you can have even a small version of the map, if you can somehow indicate what areas are going to be changed as opposed to redrawing the whole roadway. Just, okay, we have a problem corner here, we have problem trees here, that's what's going to be addressed. I think that would really address what we need.
Okay. Any other comments here? Yes, Nancy.
The other problem is the dead-end roads. And we do have, I mean, we can't be flexible on those. And you have given us some alternatives tonight. And I can understand why, from your standpoint, they're not very appropriate. But, you know, if you could agree on something that would fit the ordinance, that would be helpful for us too.
Are those alternatives ideas that the board would feel comfortable with? Mm-hmm. I realize that that's a whole different issue than the road width and the fire protection issue, but they really are very real issues.
I can see that they kind of fly in the face of your concept. But I'm not going to say which one looks good to me right at the moment. I think it's up to you to agree on what's right for you and then present it to us. Mm-hmm. Something that wouldn't fly in the face of the 1,000-foot ordinance.
Right. The other option, of course, is to think that maybe at some point that section of the ordinance needs to be revisited. But that's a process that we don't necessarily want to go down.
For that.
Well, yes.
Mr. DeWan, since that is a sort of a new design, different from what's in the original application, and represents a change and an amendment, if you will, to the application, if that's something you would wish to pursue and workshop with us, we'd be very happy to kick it around and take a look at any ideas you might have there.
When are we planning to come to the workshop session then next month?
May 5th is our next workshop, and we do not have a heavy agenda for it. Oh, wait a minute. I had another question about material for the next round, and we've only done one project here since I've been on the board that has fire pond. Fire pond used for fighting fires in a small five-house neighborhood. And some of the information which we reviewed at that point in time, again, it was at the request of the fire chief, had to do with the seasonal depth of the pond, how much water would be in the pond, in addition to the sort of things of, you know, putting in the equipment and doing the excavation and whatnot, in terms of verifying the number of gallons of water that would be in the pond. Do you have a handle as part of this application on what the capacities are of all your fire ponds?
I believe some of that information is in the information that's before the board already. Mm-hmm. When we were out with the chief the other day, he's a wealth of information about where the water's coming from,
okay,
and how the pond goes dry and so forth. And we do know that some of the ponds are going to have to be excavated. Mm-hmm. That, of course, gets into issues relative to wetland impacts and so forth. And we have had well alternatives go out
and do an analysis of each one of the ponds with that in mind.
Okay. Because I don't remember seeing sort of an actual table of how many gallons per pond or now and in the future or anything like that.
There was a chart that we submitted that showed existing conditions. We didn't include anything relative to volume.
Okay, but that's how you made that chart, was by looking at volume?
We did describe in that chart, if there were improvements that needed to be made, what would trigger those improvements?
Okay.
When those would be made.
Okay, and if you have a pond that you dig down, does it automatically fill back up with water and doesn't just make a pond of the same volume at a lower elevation? Are you comfortable? How does that work? Educate us. Okay.
I met with the chief a couple of years ago. We actually went out, measured the depths, widths, and put some volumes together, submitted that information to the chief. The chief actually has some rough measures of volumes. Regarding the depths and the sources of water, there are probably, I believe there's only one pond that I have sort of a concern with as far as drying up. The rest have are very good sources of water. Some, in fact, such as seasonal pond on Breakwater, and no matter how hard the chief would draw on that pond, given the source here, that would never go down. And we have some other situations similar to that. Dunham Pond is extremely deep, and most of them are man-made, but Dunham Pond is another example. Even in the driest weather, that is an extremely deep pond. And the chief has all this information we supplied.
Okay. Yes, Maureen has something to offer here also.
I understand the chief may have all this information, but I also understand that the board is asking the fire chief for some pretty concrete recommendations, and every time I talk to him, I think it would really help him to have all of this information collected and put together now, because to expect him to dig back a couple of years, that doesn't seem to be very effective.
He, in fact, said he has the file and would make it available again. And I'd be happy to help work with him to put together this information. I have it on my file as well.
I'm just suggesting that if there's a real desire to bring this issue to a close, I think the best way to do that would be to pull together a single fire protection plan that has all that information in one place so that the fire chief could look at it and some decisions could be made.
We could have that available for the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. I'd be interested in seeing something like that too, just so that we can know what's really there. Any other items that the board wishes to have addressed between now and the next month?
Mr. Wilcox, I have one before we go to a vote.
Yes.
Concerning the fire ponds, I believe it should be written somewhere within the plan as to who would be responsible for the annual maintenance, so that the town is not held responsible for making sure those hydrants are available and always work.
Okay. Anything else? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand, please. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you very much, and we will see you soon.
Yes. We'll then assume that we'll continue the discussion on the other issues. Hopefully we'll get beyond roads and fire ponds on the next meeting.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
From attorney representative Shostrake. I don't know if you folks have all seen this letter.
Which one?
It's from Evans Huber. The guy's representing Shaw's, right? No, I don't, I just need to ask the question. I mean, it seems that we have two different views of what may happen in the future. Somehow, I mean, it does seem like it may have an effect on what is before us as a subdivision if, in fact, Shaw's litigation is successful. Is there any way to get some sort of preliminary determination as to what may play out with this situation?
I'm hopeful that we are going to have that kind of indication before this process is over. That case that he refers to is before a judge for a summary judgment and should hear momentarily. And we're optimistic that the position that the Sprague Corporation is taking is the appropriate one for the corporation and for the family, and it's unfortunately that we're not able to keep everybody happy all the time.
I wish you luck. It sounds like an uncomfortable situation at best.
As far as the board is concerned, there are two issues, and I can pursue them unless you're satisfied. One of the issues is whether or not the applicant has right title and interest, and they have to have right title and interest in the property in order to pursue an application. They have submitted an application which the board has deemed complete, which means that you've basically found that they have sufficient right title and interest. In the past, when you've had an application which has been the subject of litigation, the position you've taken is that you're not going to be put in the position of arbitrating who has the right to determine what's going on. If an applicant meets a threshold level of right, title, and interest, then you proceed from that point, and the applicant is forewarned that they proceed at their own risk in case they no longer have authority to complete the approval that's been granted to them. The other issue is the issue of whether or not the purpose of the application will substantially change if ownership changes, and that's when you need to be concerned about what you grant approval for. And if there are things that could happen, you want to make sure that you carefully craft an approval that conditions what your expectations are going to happen on the property, so that if those expectations are not met, you get to have a second look at the application.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Our next item on the agenda this evening is the Lawton Lydon Public Access Waiver Amendment. A request by Larry Lydon for an amendment to a previously approved public access waiver to move the turnaround located off of Columbus Road under section 19-4-2B of the pre-June 1997 zoning ordinance. Please present, identify yourself and present us a summary of what you're doing.
Okay. My name is Larry Lydon. I'm the owner of the Lawton Lydon lot. Back in October 96, we were approved for a public access waiver. Tonight, I'm back here to ask for a revision to that access waiver. What we want to do is, in the bold lines here, we just want to move the emergency turnaround from the Lawton lot down into the right-of-way, which is owned by Mr. Mintel. And the purpose of that is just to eliminate a lot of that pavement, which would, you know, save a lot more trees and natural vegetation. Some of the notes that the town engineer has come up with, we're complete agreement with and have no problem in complying with those. I think a lot of the changes have been shown on the map. The radius, the 12-foot of pavement with the 2-foot gravel shoulders, I think that's all reflected on this plot plan. The westerly side, the radius, was not. I think that's something new, but we have no problem with that. He's asking for, I guess, for cross-section profiles, showing the 2% pitch of the road, you know, under drainage and stuff like that. We have no problem with any of that.
Okay. Very good. Thank
you. Mr. Mintel's here if you have any questions.
Okay. Thank you very much. In looking at the application, do any board members have any questions or comments? Mr. Parkhurst.
I have a motion.
All right. Go ahead.
This seems very, very straightforward to me. Anyway, motion for the board to consider findings of fact for one. L.E. Lydon Jr. Construction is requesting approval to relocate a turnaround for lot and public access waiver. Approval granted by the planning board in October 1996 for a lot located off Columbus Road. Number two, the original approval granted by the planning board included conditions which should be part of this approval. Number three, the town engineer has provided comments which will ensure proper development of the site. Number four, the fire chief has requested the driveway be given a name and the homes be numbered. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of L.E. Lydon Jr. Construction for an amendment to the previously approved Lawton Public Access Waiver located off Columbus Road to relocate the turnaround be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, plans be revised to address the issues raised in the letter from the town engineer dated 4/14/98. Number two, that the driveway be named and the homes on the driveway be numbered / renumbered, and three, that there be no issuance of a building permit nor alteration of the site until the plans have been revised and the conditions met to the satisfaction of the town planner.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Mm-hmm. Hearing none, all those in favor of the application for the amendment, raise your right hand. It's unanimous, and thank you very much for coming. Next item on the agenda this evening is a Greenview Drive Resource Protection Permit, a request by Fitzpatrick Associates for a resource protection permit to build a road to access two lots off Spurwink Ave under section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Completes. If you'll just step to the podium and give us an overview of your application.
Certainly. Good evening and thank you for hearing us tonight.
My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with Sebago Technics. Here with me tonight is Joel Fitzpatrick and Kelly Fitzpatrick. She moved on me. If it's appropriate, I can give you a brief overview of the project. We were at workshop level with the planning board, I believe it was in March, at which time we presented the basic concept. Since that time, we've developed the more detailed plans and have worked with the town engineer and the town planner in the submittal. The project before you is an application for an RP2 wetlands permit. The applicant is Fitzpatrick Associates. The project is for two single-family residential lots on a parcel of land owned by Herbert Strout. Herbert is here this evening. The property is located on the westerly side of Spurwink Avenue across from the Purpooty Golf Club. I've colored up the site plan and brought that along with us. The golf club's over here, Spurwink Avenue, and the proposed lots. As shown on the plans, we've configured the project so that each lot has road frontage onto Spurwink Avenue. We've sited the entrance road to maximize site distance while minimizing wetlands disturbance. Our soil scientist, Mark Hampton, conducted a detailed field evaluation to delineate the wetland areas. Those show up in the lighter green, these areas here and over there. So there's actually two crossings, one here and one here. As part of the proposal, we set building envelopes, which set setback lines for the zoning requirements and also establish a 25-foot wetland setback from each of the wetlands, excluding, of course, the actual wetland crossing. The lots will be served by a gravel access road. Initially, it's coming in at 16 feet off of Spurwink Avenue with an access drive to this house lot and the remaining access drive continuing to lot 2. We've designated a 30-foot wide common access easement for this portion of the driveway, lot 1 will have to use to get to the lot. This is the property line for lot 1, and lot 2 runs like that. It's pretty much the same as we had brought in at the workshop meeting. Actually, at the workshop meeting, as Joel reminded me, I showed we had just estimated where we thought the wetlands were. Joel tells me I'm awfully conservative. I had a much bigger wetland area on the site. So once we did the actual soil survey and the field delineation, we got the true wetland locations. And those were all survey located also. As part of our application, we are asking the board to consider granting two waiver requests. The first waiver request is for a 1-foot contour requirement in the wetlands area. We did do a detailed topographical survey of the site so that we could develop the grading plan and determine the amount of disturbance of the wetlands, which combined is approximately 4,000 square feet. As part of the project, we did do field evaluation to delineate the wetlands in the field based on soils, vegetation types. So we feel confident that we've located those wetlands appropriately. We do have a good sense of how the drainage works on the property. We proposed culverts at appropriate locations, one at the entrance here, the driveway crossing, and the second wetland crossing. So we'd ask the board to consider granting a waiver for the 1-foot contour requirement in the wetlands area. The second waiver request is for item C.9 of the submittal requirements for a stormwater management plan. The project's, we believe, is relatively low intensity. It's two single-family house lots. Again, we developed a site-specific grading plan, included a second sheet with some very specific erosion control and sedimentation requirements. We did do a specific grading plan in the wetland areas, which included placement of siltation fencing at the limits of disturbance and also what they call erosion control blanket in some of the ditch lines in the more sensitive areas. It helps stabilize the soil, giving the grass a better chance to get established. So we, again, that was the second waiver request that we were going to ask the board to entertain. And with that, I guess we did get some comments back from the town engineer and the fire chief. We're fine to address those. We did just submit a letter. I had Mark Hampton, our soil scientist, go back out in the field to look at the second wetlands crossing to confirm whether or not that would be classified as a stream. If it is classified as a stream, we would have needed to file a permit by rule application with the DEP. Mark did relook at it, and he is confident that it is not a stream in that area. He actually walked it the rest of the way down, and it does end up with defined channels as you do come down here towards the lower end of the property, but up in the upper end it's more of a wooded wetland area with some drainage moving through it. With that, that concludes my presentation, and we'd certainly be glad to try to answer questions or expand on anything the board would like. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Nancy.
The chief would like to have a turnaround at the end of, I guess it's, lot one or two, that one.
This lot here, I believe.
Yeah. Yes, and have you addressed that on your map?
No, we have not addressed that yet on the map. We are, I've talked with Joel, and he is okay with installing that, and we'd ask if the board approved it to make that a condition, and we will include it on the plan with a turnaround.
And just where do you think it would be?
Well, my preference would be in this location right here, or to come across and move the turnaround for the driveway here over into here on the front of the lot. And Joel will talk with the fire chief to confirm where he would prefer that. I believe that's where we discussed was either here or once you get across the stream crossing or the culvert crossing.
As our first order of business, Mr. Parker.
I make a motion.
Yes, go ahead. We shall determine completeness of the application.
A motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of J.S. Fitzpatrick Associates for a research resource protection permit to construct Greenview Drive access to two lots off Sterling Ave be deemed complete.
May I second, please?
Yes, Mr. Carter, thank you. Having a motion and a second, is there any discussion regarding completeness of the application? We've had a fairly thorough review of on the application completeness checklist, so therefore, hearing no other comments, all those in favor of deeming this a complete application, please raise your right hand. The vote was unanimous, and now we may begin review of the application. One of the things that we should look at as a board is the question of whether or not a public hearing is required for this wetlands alteration permit. The zoning ordinance, I believe, Maureen, correct me if I'm wrong, it is an optional public hearing in this case, unlike in a subdivision. So does anybody have any feelings about or comments about the need for a public hearing for this application? Yes, Mr. Parkhurst.
It seems historically that we have always taken the tack that if we can have a public hearing and invite the public to participate, that we have done so. I would be in favor of doing that in this instance.
Very good. Yes, Nancy?
I think that would be a good idea, and I frankly would like to have a sidewalk. Just a quick one, since it's a small area. But I'd like to see those wetlands. I don't know if anybody else would like to. I could always drive over.
Yes, Mr. Barkas.
Is the frontage on the front lot, is it marked? So if we do drive by, we could tell which exactly is the piece of land?
Not very well. There was a piece of, we hung some flagging out there when we did do some, we did a sidewalk earlier. I will remark that for you.
If you just mark the two corners and the frontage, that'd be great.
Okay, we can do that.
We can walk in.
No problem with us walking.
Or can you?
No, yes, I believe you can. There is, it does drop in through here. You might want to come up here on this upper end as you walk in, but once you get in here, it's very easy to walk up in. Place. I remember correctly, they walked in up over here.
Yes, we have gotten permission from the abutter, and I will check that one more time. For this little tow road right here, you might be able to park in and take a walk through there. But I will call the abutter to confirm that.
Okay.
Right now, there is no way to park. There's no place to park.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, would other board members be interested in having a site work, seeing as it requires coordination with an abutter, to just sort of take a half an hour or 45 minutes and just go meet and do it all at once? Now that we're getting into daylight hours after work, on small ones such as this, we've done that before. Meet at 5:30 or whatever and still have it over in time to go home for supper. Would there be any interest in something like that?
No problem.
No?
As long as it was held in the afternoon, I would have no objection.
Okay. Rather than knocking out a Saturday morning for traipsing all over. Okay, I think that's an excellent idea. Could we set a time to do that? Board members, anybody have a day of the week that you can't show up?
Well, next week.
Next week.
But you can do it without me.
Our town planner will be on vacation for a week, so if we do it in the next week, we'll have to struggle by and make do by ourselves.
For a week. So let's make it after that.
Anytime after May 4th.
Okay. Do you hear that, Mr. Chairman?
I think it's not unreasonable to wait until after May 4th. I'm not. We'd still have plenty of time before the next meeting, which would be on the 19th.
You could do it before the workshop on the 5th.
That's an excellent idea. Our workshop is scheduled for 7 o'clock if we just met there or a little bit earlier.
We get it done by
meet at 6.
We get there at 6. Could we get it done?
Oh, without a doubt. If it's just... Would that be okay?
Yes.
6 o'clock on the 5th?
Well, reminder, come with the workshop. Hurry up.
Yes,
that might be arranged.
Greatly.
And where do you suggest we meet?
Did you say there was no parking?
Well, the parking is very difficult along there. Joel's going to speak to the abutter to see if they can park in that driveway, or is there another location?
How about parking it for Fuda?
There is room for maybe two or three cars on that little tow road, so the next spot is for Fuda.
That's a good idea. Herb's...
It's down here, though.
Up in here.
See the towers?
There is room on the side of the road. You have to pull over. Mm-hmm.
I parked myself right here in front of the guardrail, about where the entrance is coming in. There's enough room to get off on the side there, but...
So why don't we just meet at the site?
Yeah.
I think we can...
Or why don't we meet at here and go in one or two cars? And then we're going to...
Isn't this better path from...
Pleasant Hill.
Yeah, it's just up.
We could park on this.
Park on Pleasant Hill.
I just want it to be clear so everybody knows where we're supposed to meet. We're supposed to meet at the site.
At the site.
Do your best to find a safe place to park.
Is it right across the road going into Papoota?
No.
Just look for us. I'll look for flags.
Okay.
You got a flag, right?
We'll have it marked. Pleasant Hill Road is the closest. There's a little development. Pleasant Hill Road is this little subdivision right here.
Yeah.
Pheasant.
Oh, sorry.
Pheasant.
Yes.
An error on the flags. Okay. And there. Next thing to discuss, Mr. Parkhurst mentioned the possibility, a comment in support of having a public hearing for the project, for this application. Do any other board members have any thoughts on that matter?
I think it's a good idea.
It's, okay. Anybody else? I think it's probably a good idea. Even on driveway, sort of in small scale projects such as this, just to sort of see it to know what we're talking about.
I agree that a public hearing should be held.
Okay. And we could schedule that for the May meeting.
19th.
Great. That would be fine. Okay. In looking over the application materials, does anybody have any issues or items which they feel could bear some attention between now and our next meeting?
I think it would be nice if by that time you had conferred with the fire chief mm-hmm. on the turnaround.
That makes sense. I even wrote myself a note to do that.
And you could present that.
Sure.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Let's make a motion.
Please.
Motion for the board to consider. It ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted to the PAC presented the application to Dais Fitzpatrick Associates for a resource protection permit. Greenview Drive, accessing two lots of Spurwick Ave, be tabled to the regular May 19th, 1998 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Is there a second?
Please.
Mr. Cotter seconded the motion. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. Motion was unanimous. Thank you very much.
And we'll see you at 6 o'clock May 5th.
See you May 5th.
Great.
Thank you very much. Our final item on the agenda this evening is the subdivision ordinance sidewalk amendment. The request by the Town Council to consider an amendment to the subdivision ordinance which would permit the planning board to waive the mandatory sidewalk requirement under section 16-3-6C, public hearing. Do any board members have any reactions here? Yes.
Maureen. Okay. In the letter from the town attorney, the parts that were highlighted, I assume, as just a photocopy of something, or does that mean something more than what I'm seeing? Where it says 5 feet at least.
Okay. And this is the third page in the memo you have in front of you. It starts off Monahan Leahy. It's a letter from the town attorney, and what he is doing is responding to a request from the town manager to draft a sidewalk amendment. So if you see that paragraph that's indented near the bottom of the page, those words which are in gray, I guess is what you would describe it, are new words. Words that are proposed to be added to the ordinance, and those words which have a strike through them are existing language in the ordinance which is proposed to be deleted. So this paragraph is an existing paragraph in the ordinance that would be amended as shown on this attached letter.
So in other words, in some circumstances, sidewalks should be required on both sides of the road.
Yes. Yes. You can do that now. Mm-hmm. The standards call for sidewalks on both sides of the road. And there's only two places in the subdivision ordinance that I can think of where the board's authority to waive standards is curtailed. And one of them obviously is the dead end road standard. Mm-hmm. And the other one here where you are precluded from waiving sidewalks on both sides of the street. The standard calls for sidewalks on both sides. You can waive them on one side, but you cannot completely eliminate them.
We can't.
You cannot under the current ordinance.
Oh, but now.
Under this provision, you would be allowed.
We can waive both.
Yes, you would hear.
That was my clarification.
You'd be able to hear requests for waiving all sidewalks, and you would be able to grant those requests.
As a bit of background information on the subject that we're now discussing, the town council on December 8th, 1997 voted to refer the suggested amendment to the planning board and has asked for our comments on the suggested amendment.
Well, personally, I don't have any problem with it. It gives everybody more flexibility, as I read it. So, I'll make a motion.
Oh, Mr. Parkhurst.
Go ahead. I was just going to do the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Be it ordered that the planning board does recommend the attached sidewalk amendment to the town council for adoption.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion which has been seconded. Do we have any further discussion? Yes, David.
I don't like to be redundant, but just let's review it again. What in terms it means that we would have the right as a board to waive sidewalks, rather than it be a mandatory requirement. Rather than two sidewalks, we would have one, and then we have the right to either waive it or require it. Is that the way I understand?
I
27.
Yeah. Okay, the current ordinance. Requires sidewalks on one side of the road, and that cannot be waived by the planning board. And they shall be 5 feet wide. The difference between that, and that's on page 27 of the subdivision regulations, which is chapter 16. Of the ordinance. With the changes proposed to town council, which we need to comment on, sidewalks would still be required to be 5 feet wide. They would be required on at least one side of the road, but they would be able to be waived by the planning board. One thing that I could point out here, because Mr. Parkhurst was with us on this also, was in the effort to make roads narrower and make them more appropriate for neighborhoods, part of that effort was aided by the inclusion of sidewalks. Previously, no sidewalks were required anywhere, and therefore, none were proposed anywhere. As part of the effort to scale down the widths of roads in every category of road use, mandatory sidewalks were included on at least one side of the road. So there is still a wider, improved public way, if you will. And that was done through a long study process of ordinance committee, workshop committees, planning board review, report to council, you know, the whole thing. So now we're being asked just to change it right now.
Well, I think it's very fortunate this has come along at this particular moment, because I can't see us trying to impose sidewalks in Sprague Estate.
They don't apply to private roads.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. It's the type of item which, if it is waivable by the planning board, there obviously will be cases in which the design of a subdivision would be appropriate for that to be waived. And there would be cases in which the design of the subdivision, it would not be appropriate for that to be waived. And we would then get to make the decision.
You know, another comment, if you don't mind. This type of situation, which the reason this was precipitated was by neighbors in the Rockville Highlands not wanting sidewalk in Eastward Farm Pond Road. It points out how important that public hearings are if neighbors see an addition to their neighborhood or something like that, and with the ordinance being written the way it was, and all of a sudden the sidewalk is going to start in the middle of no place and go no place. The neighbors, if they want to have some input, can say, hey, it's ridiculous to have that situation. But just goes to show that the public hearing probably is a good thing for any project that comes before us.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Uh, Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those not in favor, raise your right hand. We have a 2-2 vote. No, we have a 4-2. 4-2 vote on the motion. The motion carries. And the motion will be recommended to Town Council for adoption.
One last motion.
Yes, Mr. Farr.
That we adjourn the meeting.
Do I have a second?
So moved.
Second? All those in favor? Yay. Thank you very much.